So welcome back from break. I see that there's a fair number of you that are still on break, but such is life. At least you guys are here. Somehow the 8 a.m. class, the morning after spring break, doesn't seem to work. Nobody's ready. So as I said last class before break, this is about halfway through the semester. So that's a good thing and a bad thing on both hands. So you know we're halfway through, but at the same time we're halfway through, and that means we're almost done. So it's nice that spring break fell so conveniently. We are back to it, however. So today we're going to talk about color theory, and then next class we'll talk at much greater length about architectural diagramming, and we'll get into some more of the more fancy techniques that you can do in Illustrator. Today, in terms of the exercise, you guys got exercise 116. We're going to talk about color swatches and working with color swatches. So I have a little bit of an exercise for you to do relating to color swatches. But then after that, you're going to have a fair amount of time today to work on the Charlie Harper assignment. The Charlie Harper assignment is due a week from today. So lucky for you, it's not due today. So you have a full week now that spring break is over to concentrate on it, and it'll be due next Monday. So we'll work through it. On the handout that I gave you, I wanted to talk to you about calibrating the monitors and trying to get better color. Unfortunately, the computers when I got here this morning were locked down such that we can't have you calibrate the monitors, so without an administrator password, so there's nothing I can really do. So we're going to skip that first part and then move on to the second part. So we will go into that a little bit more as we go forward. So we're going to start today talking about color theory with examples from Charlie Harper, kind of to follow it up, because I think it's important to talk through the various examples that are out there and kind of work from a precedent when it's related to Charlie Harper. So color theory is by itself a whole topic. You could take a semester-long course in it. By the same publishers as the layout workbook that was one of the recommended books for this class, they also did a color design workbook. Very, very similar, lots of examples, lots of colors to work from. A lot of the slides that I'll show are based on information out of this, but you can tell by the thickness of this book that it is a pretty substantial topic. Not something that I can give complete justice in a 30 to 45 minute lecture, but at the same time, it's at least important to be aware, and I'm going to show you some examples today that hopefully will encourage you to be a little bit more aware as we go along. So we start with something very basic that's called the color wheel, and chances are when you were in grade school, you did this sort of thing with basic mixing of paints and that sort of thing. So move your memories back into that time frame and start thinking about the color wheel. Basically, the color wheel is an organization strategy that organizes the primary colors together. So we have our reds, which would be right here, opposite our yellows and opposite our blues as our primary colors. The secondary colors are the ones that occur in between those, and they're designated on this little graph by the S's. So those are splits between the two. If you had paints back in that elementary school classroom, if you had red and yellow paint, when you mixed them together, they'd make orange, right? Somehow this is pertinent to me. My daughter's like 5 and a half, and so this idea of mixing paints like works really nicely. Like, what color are you gonna get when you combine the two paints? So here I am telling you about it, right? So, and then the tertiaries are the middle ground colors. So if we have a primary here in red and we have a secondary in orange, we get a red-orange as a tertiary color, right? And we could break it down even further than that, but it's basically how we would end up mixing our paints together. Complementary colors are assigned by the opposites. So the complement is the opposite on the color wheel. So if we started with a yellow as the primary, the complement would be this purple over here. Right, so it's the direct opposite as we go across. If we had red, for example, as the primary, the direct opposite across the way would be green, and that would be our complementary color. So complementary colors always work nicely together. One color complements the other color. They're different enough to be nice. Sometimes it's not the best from a design scheme because it becomes very, very graphic, and I'll show you some examples of where this starts to come together. And sometimes we do like a split complementary where we take one primary color, maybe it's the yellow one here, and we split out and we do a blue and kind of a light purple. And we use those two colors in combination. Analogous colors, on the other hand, are colors that fall right next to each other on the color wheel. So the set here that I have that are kind of blown up, those are analogous colors. And they go really, really well together, but they almost go together too well. So in the world of color design, if we have a lot of these colors that are the same, it's hard to distinguish between, say, this yellow, this orange, and that orange. They all kind of blend together. And so if we had a color scheme that was based on just those colors, there would be nothing that would stand out. So there's no little piece that we would be using to kind of stand out. So like I said, they match each other well, but they don't provide a lot of contrast. Nothing to highlight something, right? They just kind of go together nicely. Color systems. And so this is something that takes a little bit of getting used to, but we have two primary color systems, and you've already been asked to pick this, whether you're working in Photoshop or Illustrator or InDesign, this option exists. And what it's referring to is how is the ultimate final product that you're creating going to be displayed? Is it going to be displayed on a computer monitor or a cell phone or something like that? In which case, it's this kind of a color system, red, green, and blue, RGB color. And that has to do with light. So we have to be transmitting light. We'll get to CMYK in just a second, which is a print form of color. But in this example, it has to do with light. So the projector that's projecting the light, or the computers that have little LEDs that are lighting behind, right? What they do is they turn on red, green, and or blue, and it's through the combination of those that we get white. So if we turn on red, green, and blue light, and we put all of those together, we end up with white light. Okay? If we put just red and blue light together, we end up with magenta light. If we put, you guys get the idea, right? Red and green together, we get yellow light. There's a great exhibit that does this at the Exploratorium. Anybody been to the Exploratorium on the pier in San Francisco? There's a great exhibit, or there used to be a great exhibit. They change the exhibits all the time. It might not be there anymore. Where they had these lights that were projecting against the wall, and as you walked across, your shadow would disrupt one or the others of the colors, and it would change the color of the shadows on the wall. It's the same kind of a thing. It's an additive light thing. So this has to do with how our screens are displayed. So when we're designing in an RGB color mode, we're ultimately looking for something that's going to be projected or displayed on a screen of some kind. The opposite of this is a CMYK system. And this has to do with cyan, magenta, yellow, and key or black. And so the easiest way to think of this is like a color laser printer. Right, we have different toner drums that stick in the color laser printer, right? One's magenta, it might be inks in your ink cartridge, right? Same concept. We have these basic colors, and those basic colors through a combination make up the other colors. So you can see by the little color wheel or the three color spheres that are overlapping here that it's almost the exact opposite of the RGB system. And so the way that this works is when you put a color on a page, okay, when we put that ink on a page, when the light hits the page, all of the colors that are the light, all of the colors that are hitting it, except for the color that we see, is absorbed by that particular color of ink. Does that make sense? So what's reflected is the color. So if we combine them together, if we take cyan and magenta together, right, the reflected color is that blue. So it's a little bit different. It's not the same as the light system where we're actually seeing the light. In this case, we're seeing what's not absorbed by the ink. Okay? So this is a very different system. And so if our intent of our design project was to print it, so maybe we're doing photography and we wanted to print something, or if we were doing a lecture series poster or the Charlie Harper assignment, those are examples of we're ultimately going to print. Therefore, we want to be in the CMYK color space instead of the RGB color space. So they're slightly different. The truth is that Photoshop or InDesign or Illustrator can convert back and forth between them. So if you ended up in the wrong color mode and you ultimately decided to print and you had an RGB document, Photoshop or InDesign would just convert that into a CMYK and send it to the printer. There are some specifics of why this is more important. Unfortunately, it's beyond the scope of what we can do in this class. If you were a serious graphic designer and you were doing this, or a photographer and you were doing this for a living, you would actually buy a special little accessory that would go on your monitor and would read the colors of your monitor and calibrate your monitor to be exact color. Okay? Therefore, you can then install a profile from the printer. The printer knows what paper and what ink is in the printer, and it can match. So what you see on the screen is exactly what comes out of the printer. Anybody ever tried to print something and had it turn out awful? Chances are in this class you printed something for me and it turned out awful, right? That's because the profile and the calibration of the monitor didn't match the profile of the printer, and when it printed, it didn't turn out well. And so if I could, and I've actually requested this over and over and over for years, to get these on these computers so that I could teach you the proper way to calibrate a monitor and get good quality prints, and we wouldn't deal with this problem anymore. But I haven't been able to get funding for that, so it is what it is. So color theory. We use color theory rather loosely, and chances are it's probably something that you're already using in the back of your mind a little bit. But color theory is essentially there are meanings or emotional associations behind all of the colors that we use, and we're using those to our advantage in our designs. So we're picking a color intentionally rather than just picking a color arbitrarily. And so we want to use that. We want to be deliberate when choosing our colors to make sure the color choice is informing and enhancing the design, not detracting from it. Color theory is at its core about developing aesthetically pleasing color relationships. So we have these colors and we want to make them work together to give us something. So there are specific colors or color groups that generally can be associated or assigned to particular emotions, right, or particular feelings. We have our warm colors, we have our cool colors, and we have our neutral colors. And then we'll get into the specifics about what red means, what orange means, et cetera. But these groups are often the easiest way of kind of generally categorizing colors. Warm colors are the reds, the oranges, and the yellows, right? They're generally associated with happiness, joy, good feelings, things like that. There is some negative to it. It could be anger, those kinds of things as well. But we'll get into those a little bit better. In 2009, right, this was one of the bubble bursts, one of the last economic collapses. A lot of websites shifted their designs to include yellow as a bit more of an optimistic, happy color to make people more happy, want to buy products. So I'll show you a bunch of website examples today that we'll go through, because I think websites are very, very good at showing how companies or designers are changing colors to try to influence how we feel about things. And websites are particularly good because it's really easy to change, and websites change all the time. So if we go back in time and we look at how websites change, we can see how these colors impact and or show certain things to us about the general economic times or the general basis of our times. So cool colors are the blues, the greens, the purples, right, those kinds of colors. They're going to be cooler or cold. No surprise that we associate it with the call it cool. Cold water, mornings, that kind of thing. They're often the most professional, clean companies. You know, they're the ones that are going to be using the blues, the well-established companies. And I'll show you this as we go forward a little bit in some of the websites. Authority, establishment, trust, they tend to be in the cool color range. Neutral colors are the grays, the browns, the blacks, the whites. Those are all not warm, not cold. Though we could get into specifics about there are warm grays and there are cold grays, depending on how much blue or yellow is in the various gray colors. But you guys get the idea. These are meant to be more neutral, not trying to evoke much emotion one or the other. So let's get into the specific colors themselves a little bit. So red is usually symbolic of fire, power, right, those kinds of things. It's actually very interesting that YouTube's color is red. I don't know that they were really intentionally picking red, but they're the one of the very, very few big websites that have red as a dominant color. And so it's just kind of interesting to look at it that way. It's generally associated with passion or importance, but it can also be on the negative side of anger, right? Activism, emergency, rage, those kinds of things can also be very much associated with red. Okay. Sometimes it's a stimulation of energy and excitement. That might have been what the YouTube people were going for when they were picking that color. I don't know how intentional that was. Orange is usually a happiness, joy, sunshine, childlike exuberance, right? It's generally a good color. It could be a little bit aggressive. It's very similar to red in its color tone. So you have to be a little careful in that realm. It can sometimes be ignorance or deceit. though it's less common, but it's certainly important. As much as we talk about the positive associations of a particular color, it's important to be aware of what the negative associations would be as well, which is why I bring those up. It was intentional that the digital tool site color was orange, right? This, I like the childlike exuberance, right? I don't know that you really feel that way, but that was my intent. I want you to be happy when you're doing this stuff. So the fact that I picked orange is actually a reason. There's a reason behind it, okay? Which is part of what I'm trying to establish in you, or to have you think about when you're doing this, is that what color you pick actually matters. Yellow is kind of the happiest color. Somehow we associate it with sunshine, and that somehow deep in our minds makes us happy. And so it's joy, intelligence, brightness, energy, optimism. Like I said, in 2009, when everything wasn't very optimistic, right? A bunch of websites put a bunch of yellow in their pages, right? Try to make us feel better. And so it certainly can do that. Negative feelings might be caution or criticism, laziness. Those might be some negative associations of yellow. Jealousy also. Green. So green is actually a very interesting thing, because green is obviously associated with nature, no surprise. Okay, green grass, nature, things growing, farming, all of those things are naturally associated with green. It's also very symbolic of money or greed or power sometimes, right? It's no surprise that if you go to most financial websites, they have green somewhere in them. Okay. It can be greed, jealousy also. I think one of the very interesting things about green is, more so than the others, which have very limited emotional obvious sets, we've adopted this notion of green beyond the color into this environmental activism, or I'm a green person. I drive a Prius, therefore I'm green. And it's kind of interesting socially that we've adopted this color out of being a color and into a general social movement. Does that make sense? So it's this idea of being green or ecologically responsible has kind of evolved the color of green that much further. So if you were doing a website or a product that was designed for this kind of a purpose, right? You wanted to put solar panels on your roof. Go look at all the solar panel companies. Every single one of their logos has green in it. Right? So this association becomes very, very important, and you want to be aware of that and what it does. So blue, we talked a little bit about blue and the cool colors. But it's generally a calming, peaceful color. It's stability or expertise, right? Whitehouse.gov, blue website, no surprise. I'm going to show you an example in just a second of that. Trust, dependability, right? It could be depression, coldness, or something along those lines as well, but generally it's just about stability. Dell, right? Big company. IBM, big company, all blue. So let's take a look at the White House website, whitehouse.gov. Okay. I'm going to bring up a bunch of political types of websites today, because I think, especially in the current climate, they're particularly relevant in terms of digesting how colors work. I am not, and I'll caution you against this, I am not by any means commenting politically on anything. Okay? This is not a political conversation. This is purely about analyzing the colors and what they mean. Okay? So I'm not trying to influence you in any way. This is not a politics class. Go to your other class for that. Okay? But I think it's relevant. So, here we are at the whitehouse.gov website. Notice we have that big blue banner at the top, right? Stability, confidence, right? I would look at this page and I would say, yeah, this seems like a very professional, right, establishment sort of page. Now, what happens if we take the same website and we flip it so that all the colors, instead of being blue, are in red? It's different. It's different, right? It's a little bit more activist. It's a little bit more, I don't know, it's hard to put your finger on it. But it's not as calm and as soothing, right? So same website, obviously they didn't suddenly switch it to being red, I switched it to being red. I did a Photoshop job on it, I did a human saturation adjustment on it with a couple little masks on it. So you can see what it would look like as red. So it's the same page, it happened to be the page from this morning, so it was a current page. But just the fact that it's switched to being red, it doesn't feel quite as establishment or quite as, hey, this is just the way life is, right? Which is not, this is obviously not the intent of what they were going for, right? So it's important to recognize how subtle shifts in color can really make a big difference. Purple is kind of a funny, it's a funny color. Anybody know what the major website that uses purple is? There's really only one. Nobody? No ideas? I guarantee you, you've all been to it. Yahoo. Yahoo is the pool, is the purple company. And actually, there's been huge articles written about how ridiculous it is that Yahoo is trying to brand itself as purple. And I'm going to show a bunch of examples over time of Yahoo and purple, because I think it's interesting. But purple is very much, or has been very much, associated with the color of royalty or luxury or wealth. And I think it had to do, if we go back way in the historical record, it had to do with if you could afford the purple dyes to make your clothes purple, that was a big deal. And so therefore, we have that association. And it's carried all the way through to today. And so when you choose to use purple, you're making a statement. Now, if you asked my daughter about her favorite color and it was purple, it probably has nothing to do with wealth or luxury. It has to do with she likes purple, you know? So we get trained over time to have this sort of thing happen. So it can also be a spiritual color or a creative color, depending on how you're looking at it. It can be associated with the feminine qualities or for healing or something along those lines. It can also be kind of a gloomy sadness sort of color. Black is generally correlated with power or elegance or grace. It works obviously very well with white, which will be the next color. But it can also be very much associated with death or mourning. So it definitely has a negative side to it. And so you want to think about, are you using black in its appropriate context? White is generally symbolic of purity. There's a reason that women wear a white wedding dress. Right, there's a certain purity standard associated with white. And so we end up falling into this social convention of white being pure. Cleanliness, safety. It could also be a cold or a distant color. Snow is white, for example. So we have a little bit of an association there as well. So research reveals that human beings make unconscious judgments about a person, an environment, or an item within 90 seconds, which is not a long period of time. Okay, of the initial viewing, and that between 62 and 90% of that initial judgment comes from color. That tells you how important color is, right? So this is research done by the Institute for Color Research. Kind of interesting. So what color you choose can really, really make a difference. What color you wear can really, really make a difference. I think it's really fascinating that architects love the color black, right? You guys have been to your reviews, and like 90% of the visiting reviewers that come in wear black. Have you noticed this? Right? When I did my master's thesis review, 99% of the people in the room wore black. It was quite entertaining, right? So somehow, I don't know, we get excited about this power thing and we all like to wear black or whatever. And so it's one of those things to be aware of, right? Do you deliberately decide to be in that realm? Do you wear black when you're presenting your presentation, or do you wear like yellow or something? You know, so my point is that you have to think about these things and decide what you're going to be wearing. I'm nice and neutral today. I'm wearing gray, right? Anyway, that first impression. So let's look at this one, the color emotion guide. I really like this graphic. It takes a long time to actually digest what's going on in this graphic, but they've taken the colors that I've just talked about with the same kind of themes that I've talked about, right? Red being an example of that bold excitement color, green being the example of farming and whatever. And so if we look at each of these kind of little sections here, like if we look at green, there's John Deere, big tractor company, all about farming, right? Obviously, it's going to be a green logo, right? If we look at, say, the purple, right? The purple's kind of an interesting one. I told you Yahoo, right there in the middle, there's Yahoo. But there's some other ones that are kind of interestingly purple, right? Hallmark, I guess maybe, you know, luxury to be able to send cards or something, right? It's just kind of, it's interesting. Taco Bell, why is Taco Bell associated with luxury? I don't know. But at the same time, it's a conscious decision. They chose to make their logo purple. Right? It's not just something that happens in a vacuum. A lot of times a company will do tons of market research in presenting these to small subgroups, and people will vote on which feels right. Right? It's just kind of interesting. Right? The blue range, right? If we look at the blue range right here, every one of those is trying to be a big established company, right? GE, Dell, AT&T, right? HP, Facebook, right? These are all big companies, stability, et cetera, right? The orange ones, right, are kind of interesting randomness out there. I like that Harley Davidson is somehow in the orange category. I don't know. You know, but it's when you look at something like this, it's interesting to see what certain companies are picking. Obviously, there's this group up here that are trying to do all the colors. So Windows, eBay, NBC, they're trying to do all the colors. And so there is that strategy, but then there are very specific strategies with colors. There is also, of course, the grays that include Apple, right? Nike, Puma, right? Black and white, gray as well. Okay, so let's look at some case studies. I told you we had to look at case studies today. And of course, we're going to start with Yahoo, right? Yahoo, vintage 1996. Some of you were probably just born. It's really scary. I remember going to Yahoo in 1996. Anyway, so this isn't particularly exciting, is it? Right? The web's changed a bit since 1996. So if we look at this, the Yahoo logo is red, right? Kind of pinkish red. But that would be about kind of excitement, new. Well, guess what? The internet was kind of new. Yahoo was a new company. It was a new thing. So it kind of makes sense. The blues for all the links, that was just kind of the color of links at that point. So I don't know that it was really intentional. It's just kind of the way it works. Sam, did you have a question? No, okay. So let's go forward. Let's go to the year 2000. Okay, so we fast forward 4 years. Notice the influx of green on this page. And I know this is subtle, and you guys are looking at it, smiling, saying, this is kind of ridiculous, right? There's like no photos on the page. There's nothing, right? But here we are, influx of green, big ticket item, shopping, right? Well, in the year 2000, online shopping was kind of a big deal, right? It was the first time you could really buy something and have it shipped to your door, right? Amazon wasn't a big player. It wasn't about Amazon Prime and I have it here in 2 days, right? That didn't exist. So the fact that you could buy something online, thousands of stores, millions of products, right? It's very interesting to see how that is a very subtle thing that Yahoo chose to do to emphasize this idea of shopping. So the fact that color was introduced, look, it's even all the way up here, right, at the top. That bar that goes across under the Yahoo icons, ugly as they are, right, is green. So is the center right there, and so is this whole big box, all about that. All right, 2003, fast forward 3 years. Okay, so we're getting, number one, our first hint of purple in the news marketplace. A little bit of purple, a little bit of blue. Yahoo logo is still red, so they've been keeping that around for a while, right? Still lots of links, but we're actually starting to get some ads. We're starting to get some full color images, right? Whatever the bookworm game, right? Yahoo Games. I don't know, it's kind of interesting to see that. Anyway, sorry. Okay, let's fast forward a little bit to 2005. Okay, this was in February, so no surprise that Yahoo Shopping was trying to push a little bit about Valentine's Day in this time frame, right? So pink, red, kind of makes a sense, the passionate color. They're pushing that a little bit. That makes sense. Yahoo logo still red, little bit thicker purple bands on the side. So we're getting a little more purple. 2007, we want to be like Google. We're going to strip everything off our homepage. Well, maybe not. We'll go back. 2009. So Yahoo went through a transition. Yahoo, I'm picking on them. I apologize. If you guys use Yahoo Mail, congratulations. But the point is that this is a brand that has been around for a while. And it's interesting to see how their ups and downs kind of reflect a website. It's changed a lot. That's part of why I'm showing it. So here we are. In 2009, Yahoo's going purple, right? We want to be this luxury brand. We want to be the high-end online search engine / email provider. I don't know that that's particularly a successful choice on their end, but they elected to go this direction. The Yahoo logo changed to purple, right? You see purple as the dominant color throughout the page, except for the web search button, right, which will change to purple soon. But you see a lot more of this purple as the highlighted color. Even the image that they're showing on the page is purple. Right, so they're really pushing this as a general color scheme. 2013, we go forward a few more days. Purple bar all the way across. I told you that yellow search box would go away. They've now made it blue in 2013. But again, lots more purple. But the purple has changed to be a little bit darker purple. Did you see that? Subtle shift, a little bit darker. Let's go forward to today. The purple is even darker. So as we look at this progression over time, 2009, it was a lightish purple. 2013, 4 years later, a little bit darker purple. Now we look today, it's almost black. So they're pushing the envelope of going into that more stable, neutral color territory. So just interesting to see how this happens. And I point these out and I go over these back and forth because at the same time that we're analyzing the big corporate structure and what's going on, these little color choices really matter. And you can see how much just the color makes a difference. So when you think about that color, you have to pay attention. So I couldn't resist, right? We know that I like Apple products, okay? Apple 1997. Kind of entertaining, isn't it? At least it had some graphics on it. But it's pretty bad. Big dominant red bar. Right? Again, internet, new, exciting, kind of a fun thing. So let's push that. The links are blue. There's a little bit of blue in there, you know, introducing the BMW CyberDrive. I don't even know what that is, but it obviously never resulted in anything. Okay, so let's go to 1998. So that was before Apple almost died. 1997 was the death of Apple and the rebirth in the Steve Jobs era. And we went back. 1998, May 8th, 1998, big change. Steve Jobs strips out all that stuff. We go very black, white, right, with the highlighted color of the old school like Mac computer. You guys probably don't even remember this stuff. It's really funny, right? Some of us do. Look at the laptop. This is like hideous. Anyway. So let's go forward. The year 2000. It's kind of scary that this was the year 2000, and this is what computers look like in the year 2000, right? You guys are looking at it now, going, "Oh my God." Okay, so this purple, right? The point is, this is intentional. Okay, we know with Steve Jobs at the helm, everything that happened was gone over very carefully and was very, very intentional. So look at this. Okay, we have the Mac computer. Right, the very first iMac or eMac or whatever it was at the time in the year 2000, Steve Jobs took Apple, which was dead, resurrected it with a product like this that tried to remarket and rebrand the whole idea of what a computer was. He wanted it to be placed in a position of luxury. This is now not the bottom of the barrel thing that you should have thrown out. This is a high-end, nice-looking device. Right? And certainly we've all become addicted to those devices over time. But this was the first example of that. And these came in three or four colors. You know, there was like a teal and an orange one and whatever. They didn't pick that for this homepage. They picked the purple one because it was the luxury item. It's the association there. Interesting. So let's go forward. Right? Apple 2001 wanted to be a little bit more stable. Hey, we're back. We're making good products. Right? We're starting to push the boundaries. We have OS X out now. We want it to be, hey, this is a nice, stable company. We're going to switch into the blue color scheme. And so we see the blue Apple logo. We see the blue X on OS X. I think it's somehow fitting. You know, there's a reason I chose the image that I did. Illustrator 10. Right? We're all in Illustrator CS6, which is what? Illustrator, it's about Illustrator 18 or 20 or something like that. So. We've gone forward a little bit, but it's kind of entertaining. Okay? Star Wars Episode 2. All right, so 2002, right? We strip that blue color away and we go into the gray realm. When we know Apple's big on the gray, so no surprise we're going in that direction. Look at how chunky that laptop is. Sorry, it's just entertaining to see this stuff, right? Holiday gift guide in green. Right, buy your products online. Remember, when we went back to the Yahoo stuff, they were pushing online shopping. Apple pushing online shopping as well. Back to the luxury, back to the big purple. Anybody remember these ads? Yeah. You were probably like six or something, right? Scary. Okay, first iPod, right? They went through this whole series of ads, the color backdrops. Again, they picked the purple because the iPod is the luxury item, right? You could buy a similar music player for cheaper, but if you bought the Apple one, you bought the luxury one. So all of this association is critical. So then we move almost 2006, almost entirely black and white, right? Pushing the beauty of this industrial design, right? Pushing the power of these computers. This is about when Apple switched over into the Intel processors. So they were really trying to switch from, hey, we have these computers that are really nice, into now you have a computer that's better than a Windows machine, or is comparable or equal to a Windows machine. So they're pushing, hey, our computers look pretty, and they perform like the Windows machines, right? So black and white, kind of high drama. So 2007, notice the bar at the top of the page has shifted. It's still kind of bubbly, right? It still sticks out, has a little bit of shadow on it, but it's very much in grayscale, very much in black and white, and obviously they're pushing the fancier looking iMacs. 2010, doesn't this look old? Don't these phones look really old? That wasn't that long ago, right? So we push the iPhone. Notice up at the top, we've got the same gray bar, right? Black, no color, right? Little bit of color in the images. We go forward into 2011. The gray bar gets a little bit darker, the white lettering instead of the black lettering. So again, very subtle changes. 2013, still that shininess, right? Still there, right? We get the new iPhone 5. Then September 18th, 2013, big time date in the world of graphic design. And I've alluded to this before when we talked about it. That's when iOS 7 came out. And I know we're on iOS 9 now, so it's kind of old news. But Johnny Ives, the lead designer at Apple, did something really major with iOS 7. It was the first time that somebody had actually changed what we were used to seeing. So everything prior to that point was shiny with shadows. All the icons, everything was like that. Johnny Ive said, no, we're going to go flat UI, which everybody at the time was saying, wow, that's going to be really boring. No more shadows, no gloss, nothing like that. But it completely changed the whole landscape of websites and design. And if you look at everything now, it's based on something that Apple did in this 2013. So I pin this as a very important date for what happens. So we go forward from there into 2014. Right? These color boxes with the little bit of padding around them, right? If you go to Berkeley's architecture site, right? We're redoing the DVC architecture site right now. It's all based on this same kind of thing. The colored boxes with the little white borders and whatever. That's now the trend. That's what we're expecting to see. Okay? We still have a little bit of shine, and I'm surprised that in 2014 they hadn't gotten rid of the shine yet. Right? I would have thought that that would have been a more serious update. We go forward into 2015. Shine is completely gone. We're into the flat UI completely. We have that gray bar, no more shine, very clean. And this is very fitting of iOS 7 and up and the flat UI design that we're dealing with now. Okay, so the website really hasn't changed much in those. So as of this morning, 2016, that gray bar has turned almost black. So the color shifted a little bit further. And at the same time, we have the same very clean, very flat UI, emphasis on fonts and typography rather than shininess and shadows. Okay, so further analysis. So like I said, I was going to show some political stuff today. And it's not because I have any kind of a commentary. But I think it's really interesting when we look at it in this light. Okay, so you guys all are aware that there is a bunch of election stuff going on. Maybe, maybe not. Okay. So there happen to be five candidates that plus or minus are trying to run for president. Okay? All five of those candidates have websites. So let's take a look at those websites and see what they might say about a particular candidate. So we'll start here with Bernie Sanders' website. Okay? Recognize that, of course, these particular sites are all have to do with somebody wanting to be president of the United States. Right? So we have a certain color scheme that we have to start with. Okay? Red, white, and blue.
No surprise, if you're running for president of the United States, you're not going to pick green or purple or something else, right? So it would make sense that you're going to be in one of those kind of color schemes. So we look here, and we look at Bernie's page here. Obviously, he's emphasizing a lot of diversity of color in that photographic backdrop, okay, which is certainly intentional. He's picked a lighter blue, right? I would argue that this blue color is somewhere in between Twitter's blue and Facebook's blue, right? Facebook's blue is a little bit darker. This one's kind of in the middle ground. Twitter's blue is a little bit lighter. So he's trying to position himself for the audience of people who are used to seeing that color, okay? We have the reddish contribute button, and that's about it. So not a whole lot of color other than the big photographic backdrop. Okay? Well, so let's jump forward. Let's look at Hillary's site. Hillary Clinton, another candidate. Okay? The blue is very light. Interesting. Okay? This is very much the Twitter, the social media blue. Right? It's that light blue. So she obviously, and look, get text from Hillary. It's something about this kind of social collaborative, I'm trying to connect to younger people movement. Okay? If we go back and we think about her actual candidacy, she's obviously running against Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders has a lot of support in the 18 to 25 or 18 to 30 demographic of people. So look, she's picking these colors intentionally to try to target those people in that age bracket, because this is a color that they're used to seeing. Interesting to see these kinds of associations. Okay? So we've got that kind of lighter blue, we've got a little bit darker blue, but still obviously within the color scheme of I'm running for president of the US, it has to be red, white, and blue. So let's flip over and look at the Republican side of things. Kasich is one of the Republican candidates, much deeper, darker blue running across the top might indicate something about stability of the candidate, or that he's an older candidate. He happens to be kind of running on both of those platforms. So it's important to recognize, right, that the choices he's making, or yeah, I'm sure it's not him making the choices, his web designer is making, is reflecting who he's trying to portray and what his candidacy might be. Another candidate on the Republican side would be Ted Cruz. Okay. No, it's Ted Cruz's website. Looks Romney-esque, but yes, this is Ted Cruz's website. I didn't put the picture there. Okay, much more black and white, very little amount of color. Okay, not a deep dark color, but if we actually kind of squint at the image for a second, there's a fair amount of red out there. So he chose that image with a little bit of red. Maybe he's trying to prod a little bit of people. Maybe he's trying to get people a little bit angry, something like that. So there's a little bit of red in that backdrop. And if we looked at that in contrast to the Bernie Sanders, there really isn't any red in that. So he's using a little bit of red to try to help his case, so to speak. Okay. So it's just kind of interesting to see how that works. A lot of black, though. The bottom is black. Right, dark ceiling in this, right? Something about the stability, the neutrality, or something is also trying to come across. So I think these are particularly interesting to look at. Now, obviously, I couldn't resist showing this one as well, okay? Because we've got Donald Trump, who's one of the other big candidates. And I think it's kind of interesting because he's the one person who's pursued the big red bar. Nobody else has that. Right? And so obviously he's running on a, we're going to make America great again, hence the slogan there. But he's also, if you've paid attention to the news, is a little bit more of an extreme candidate in terms of really pushing this, you know, something's wrong, we need to fix it, we need to be angry about it, etc. Right? So he's the one in this website who's actually pushing the big red bar. So it's interesting to see how these associations come across and the messages that they're trying to portray, right? And we have a unique opportunity. I can show you these. Maybe I'll be able to show them in the fall, and then after that I won't be able to show you these. But it's a very current opportunity to see how color can make a big impression on people, right? Now, so all of you, right, we read that quote that said, you have 90 seconds to decide. Right, you have an impression after 90 seconds. So I just showed you all of these websites for at least 90 seconds each. So you all should have an impression about who these people are, whether you've seen him or not. I'm not going to ask what your impressions are, but it's kind of interesting. This website, or these websites, are trying to get you to have a certain impression. And you want to think about that. So there are some websites that we're going to view a little bit more today. Palatin is one. It's a great website. We'll start with that one. Colored is a good website for graphic designers because it will help you analyze things that have color in them and pick certain color schemes from those particular colors. And then Color Lovers is another one that's kind of in the same vein. And so we'll talk about those. So I did say that I would show some Charlie Harper examples and talk through the Charlie Harper examples. So we'll go through these. This isn't going to take nearly as much time, but it's important to at least kind of talk through them. So Charlie Harper was a graphic artist and illustrator. His heyday was the 50s and 60s. And so he, in kind of a weird fitting way, was all about flat design. There's no shadows, right? There's just geometric shapes. Kind of relevant today at the same time. So it's certainly fun to look at it. So I'm going to flip through a lot of his images, but I think one of the biggest things that's important to understand about the Charlie Harper images is there's nothing that's in perspective. There's nothing that's three-dimensional. They're very much graphic shapes, right? If we looked at this particular swan, for example, right, we have the S that makes up the neck here, right there, right? We have the body that is one big kind of pointed ellipsoid there. And then, of course, we have these that are each a curve that go off. And we have a couple triangles that make up the beak. So it's very simple in its shapes. Obviously, the leaves, right, are these ovals, et cetera. It's very simple in its shapes, but at the same time, it represents an animal. Most of his stuff had something to do with animals. Right? Another example here, notice the composition, very strong, established diagonal composition. So we talked about diagonal composition strategy in the Photoshop section. No surprise it correlates really well to this. So don't forget about all the things that we talked about relating to graphic design, or excuse me, relating to photography. Right? Another example here, a lot of Charlie Harper's deal with repetition, the same, the same, the same, and then one different. Right? In this case, we've got the same vultures, one's reflected. He also draws movement as these isolated little curves. So things like the hummingbird wings are a series of wings that are all drawn, overlapping, right, to make up those wings. And so he does that in repeated manners on all of these movements, and you'll see it as we go forward into multiple slides. Anything with movement is kind of those in a general strategy. He also loves his graphic backdrops. Oops. So in this particular example, we have this series of circles that repeat over the course of this, right? It's missing the one that would be there. There, there, right? You get the idea. And so he's adapted it such that, right, one of the circles here becomes the head. We've eliminated it such that the body goes through those. But it's based on that very strong graphic backdrop. So when you're thinking about laying it out, if you start from something like this, a lot of times you can be more successful. Another example here, again, good composition, rule of thirds used. Right? Again, basic shapes. Even though this is a semi-three-dimensional animal, right? The shading gives it a little bit of dimension, but it is very much a flat object. Right? If we looked at each of the legs, for example, they're just one color. Then the body's a slightly different color. So those would be analogous colors, how they work together. 1954. Lots of birds, lots of fish. I like this one with the ticks. I think this one is particularly well done because it has a lot of layers to it, right? It's represented, the rings represent the surface of the water. The leaf is the topmost layer. Then we have the rings that go around. The bug with his little rings as well on the surface, and then everything below that layer is all stuff that's under the water, the fish, the snake, the bugs. It's kind of this really nice layering effect in terms of how he does it. But again, no perspective. The dog and the cat. So there he is. Sorry, the image is blurry. Okay, so let's look at some of the student work that people have done. So what I'm going to ask you in relation to the student work is not to completely come up with something entirely on your own. You don't have to just like, oh, I'm going to draw a bird and start drawing it. What I think is a lot of times relevant is to go find an example image of Charlie Harper that he's done and then base your work on that. So maybe the bird isn't a bluebird, it's a, you know, it's a cardinal or something. So you've changed the colors, you've changed the general look, maybe you changed the beak, but you're not trying to recreate this in its entirety. Does that make sense? So what I want you to do is I want you to go through and find a precedent, and you're going to do this today as part of your exercise, and then modify it to be part of, you know, your own design. So it's not a direct copy, it shouldn't be the exact same thing, but it should be some variant on something that he's done. And some of the best ones that have been done are very clean. I thought this was particularly well done. Little knife in the back. Right? This one came from a I'm going to scratch your back thing, and it evolved into the knife. Right? That could be a Charlie Harper. I thought this one was a good adaptation of the raccoons, the barbecue. The flamingo, a little bit more, but again, very geometric based. I've always liked this one just because it works a lot with patterns and repetition, and the fact that the elephant breaks the boundaries in this lower corner right here, that elephant with his trunk going up into the upper set, I think works really nicely graphically. Notice that it falls really nicely on the rule of thirds if we were to divide this up. So from a layout standpoint, it's really well done. Okay, so this was my note on the program that we were going to use to calibrate the monitors, but we don't get to do that because you need an administrator password. So, okay, so we're going to switch over, and I'm going to walk you through these color websites and how to pick your colors. So bear with me for a second while we switch. Okay, so for exercise 116, as I said, the bulk of what you're going to be working on is your Charlie Harper and getting started on that, getting your curves ready and your lines ready for that. But I also want to talk through kind of the extension of this color theory and picking some color swatches, et cetera. So under part one, you're going to select a sample Charlie Harper image. So you can do a Google search for Charlie Harper images, and you're going to pick something that you're going to base your work on. I want you to make a post, its own separate post for exercise 116, that is this image. So you're committing to this is the image I think I'm going to work from and adapt. That way you've at least looked at them and you're at least starting on it. Does that make sense? So I'm pushing for you guys to get started today. So you can do that on your own. You don't need to watch me go through that. We get into part two. We're going to follow Photoshop 1.23 color swatches to create a color swatch using the Palatin website. So I'm going to go ahead and go to the Palatin website. And I'm probably going to spell it wrong. It's one L. So this is Palatin.com. This is the color scheme designer. And so we can see here, and again, it looks a little bit worse on the projector than it does on screen here, but we have the ability to come around and pick a variety of colors based on the color wheel. And you see that my colored square on the side there changes based on what the primary color is that I'm picking. When I'm in this first mode here, it's called monochromatic, which basically means I'm picking one color and then I'm getting variants of that one color. The one color is the primary color, and then these are variants. It's the darker, you know, very dark, slightly darker. This is obviously my color, lighter, and very light. So it's a monochromatic color scheme. All would be in the same color. If I move over here, right, this next one would be the analogous or adjacent colors. And if we look at the square, it's very much kind of all colors that go together. There's not a lot of contrast provided by those colors. But again, I can move the center at any point around, and I can get analogous colors that work together.
They call it adjacent colors, but in my lecture I called it analogous colors. As we move over, right, we have a triad or three colors. This is also a split complementary. So we have a primary color. The complementary color would be directly opposite the primary color, but instead of picking the direct opposite, we're going slightly over and slightly over to have a split complementary. So we'll pick our primary, and notice that when we pick our primary, we get two secondary colors that go nicely with the primary, but you can see that there's enough contrast to where they would work well together as a grouping of colors. And so as we swing this primary around, you can see that that changes. And you could imagine using these colors, for example, in a website, right? And how they would go nicely together, depending on what color. If we come over to the next option here, which is a tetrad, we end up with basically two splits. Which one's my primary? This is my primary as we swing it around. And so we have a complementary opposite one and a complementary opposite the other, and these two are adjacent. So this one's less likely to end up as good. So for example, you can see that these two are very, very close to one another, and they don't provide a lot of contrast. So chances are you're going to be in the realm of this triad or three colors. Okay, and so you can play around with that. There is a freestyle where you can pick one color, and then you could adjust. I forget where you adjust the settings here. Well, we'll stick with the split complementary for now. And so I will pick a color that I like. Maybe that one. Right? And then once I have a set of colors that I like, notice that I could also hold shift to move shades individually, and I can also adjust the lightness and darkness of these colors using this middle realm. Okay, so now that I'm done, I'm going to go up and let's see where they have it, tables and export. So I have my primary color, right, which is the big color here. It's listed as a hex value, so AA8B39. It's also listed as an RGB value, 170-139-57. Now, I could write these down, and I could recreate them in Photoshop or in Illustrator. So for example, let me go ahead and open up Illustrator. I'm just going to show you where this is. This is not something that you have to do. Okay, so here I am. I'm going to open up the colors, okay? R, G, and B right there. There's my hex value. So if I went back, oops, and I took this one, 482E74, and I typed that in here, 482E74, I would end up with that purple color. Do you guys see how that works as a hex value? I could also come back and I could look at this RGB value, 7246116. And if I went to Illustrator, 7246116. So you see the hex value obviously corresponds, so I wouldn't have to type that in. But either method, I could type that in and get the color. Okay? But it's a little bit annoying to have to do that over time. So we're going to use something called a color swatch that will allow us to save this grouping of colors. So let me come back here, and if I come down on this list to color swatches, right, I can save it as a PNG image, as an ACO file, or as a GPL file. We're going to click on ACO. And it's going to download a file to my downloads folder called mypalette.aco, which contains information about these colors. Now, this would be great if it opened in Illustrator, but it doesn't. So unfortunately, it's a Photoshop palette, so we're going to need to open up Photoshop. So I'm going to go to my Design Standard CS6, and I'm going to go ahead and open up Photoshop. And this, by the way, is all written out on the digital tools site. If we went to tutorials, Photoshop 1.23, color swatches, everything that I'm doing is written out right here.
just so you know. Okay, so let's go back to Photoshop here. And I'm going to go to the File menu. Maybe it's the Edit menu. Yep, Edit menu, Presets, Preset Manager. And that's going to bring up this little dialog box called the Preset Manager dialog box. Right now, we're looking at all of my brush presets. I don't want brushes. I want swatches. So we'll go to the next one down, and I'll pick swatches. And so these are the swatches that are by default loaded into Photoshop. I want to load the additional ones. So it's important to kind of make a note on where the last swatch is that was already loaded into Photoshop is, such that you can see your new colors. Okay, so mine was this kind of pukey brown color. So I'm going to go ahead and click on the Load button, and I will then go to my Downloads folder, I hope. Users. Never mind. Let me copy it to my flash drive. Because I know then. Let's show in folder. All right. Let me copy this over to my flash drive, and I'll know where to find it. We probably need a folder for today. All right, let me paste that there. All right, so let me go back to Photoshop. Sorry about that. And let me go to my flash drive, into today's folder. And there it is, the mypalette.aco file. I'll go ahead and click Load. And when I do that, starting right after that brown, I get the new set of colors that came in. So these are all the exact same colors that were on the Palatin website right here. So they brought in those colors, so I don't have to type in the values, which is really convenient. Now, I'd like to be able to take these and make them something that I can open in Illustrator. Because, again, Illustrator, it would be just great if Photoshop and Illustrator and everything were cross-compatible. You would think, given that Adobe makes all the products, they would do this, but such is life. Okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold down Shift, and I'm going to select the whole group of colors that I brought in. So I clicked on the first color, and I held down Shift, and I clicked on the last color. Right? Now, your instant reaction is going to be to click Save Set. Okay? Unfortunately, this just saves it as the same file format that I just loaded, so it doesn't work. So instead, I'm going to click the little gear icon right here, and I'm going to go to Save Swatches for Exchange. And when I click on Save Swatches for Exchange, that's going to make a file called an ASE file that I can open in Illustrator, InDesign, and Photoshop. So that's the ultimate one. So it'd be nice if the website just created the ASE file for us, but they don't. So we're going to save it as a .ASE. It's going to go in here, and I'll name it something like Exercise 116 Colors. And I'll click Save. And so now I have that available in Photoshop. It already loaded up in Photoshop. I can click Done. But I can go into Illustrator, and I can load those swatches. So if I come over here, and again, I'm in the Essentials workspace. If I come over to my swatch panel here, right here, it's not loaded yet, but I can go ahead and I can load it. So I'll click on the little flyout menu, and I'll say Open Swatch Library, Other Library. And I'll go to my flash drive, into today's folder. And I'm going to pick that ASE file and click Open. And when I do that, there's my whole color set. Okay? So this is compatible with InDesign, Illustrator, and Photoshop, which is the ultimate of what we want. Okay? So I'll go ahead and I'm going to show you guys how it works, and this is the part that you're going to work to create. So we already finished part two, and we're going to work on part three, and we'll go to one of the other websites in just a second. But on the Digital Tools site, under today's exercise, I've made something for you.
and that is a file with a bunch of squares that you'll be able to apply your color swatch to. So the one that I happen to have has 15 colors, so I'm going to download the one that says the color swatch sample file 15 colors. And I keep clicking the wrong buttons today. Go ahead and load that up. There it is. And so this has squares that I can then apply all of my colors in. So I already have my exercise 116 colors. I'll click the first square. It looks like they're grouped. Let me ungroup them. Sorry. I should have done that before. Yeah, they're all ungrouped now. So the top row was grouped, so I just right-click on it and say ungroup. That's my mistake. And I'll click on the first swatch, and it'll turn to that color. I'll click on the second swatch, it'll third, fourth, and fifth. And then I can work my way through the next set of colors. And then I can work my way through the last set of colors. And the reason that I'm asking you to do this is this act confirms that you were able to create the swatches on the website, open them in Photoshop, create an Exchange file, drop them into Illustrator, and then use the swatches. Okay, so this gets you all the way there. So once I have this, I'm going to do a save for web of this file. And it's really, really tiny. Make that a little bit bigger. And I'll go ahead and click save. And let's see here. We'll call this and I'll go ahead and click save. So now I have this saved with these squares, and I can create a post on the website that will include my swatch file and my image file. So if I go to new post, I'll use the image as my featured image, and I'll insert the swatches themselves straight into the post. So we'll get to that in just a second. I would like to point out that under resources, there's something called swatches, where you can see color swatch groups that other people have created. There are a few featured swatches that may be relevant to you. Some of these are based on the like Prismacolor colored markers, and so if you want to use colors in Illustrator that are those colors that match up, you can download sets of those. One of them, this first set, the architectural set, actually has, I've spent a little bit more time, it only works in Illustrator. I don't know whether you can see this. See how it has a few streaks that are in it? So it will mimic as if you actually hand colored a particular region, which is kind of nice. But this is just the architectural marker set of colors. So it's a limited set of colors, but you can download those. It's right here. If I were to download those, if I click on them, they'll download. They download as an AI because they have these little streaks behind them. So they only work in Illustrator. But I could save those to my flash drive. There. And then I can, for example, go ahead and open those. Same method for opening them. Click the little flyout menu, open swatch library, other library, and this time I will pick the architectural markers. And there they are. These opened in two separate tabs. There's the architectural markers. So for example, I could pick one of these squares and I could apply it. I'm trying to see if there's one that you can see the streaks. That one, you probably can't see it there. You guys can try it out. But these work nicely kind of in their basic muted browns and grays, etc. That work nicely for a little diagramming and stuff. So I'll bring those up again next class, and you guys can see those again. But I at least like to point those out. OK, so I'm going to go back to another one of the color websites, which is colored.com. And it was done in the realm where we like to drop vowels. So it's C-O-L-R-D, colored.com. And so this colored website is a little bit different than the Palatin website, which is all about the color wheel and then establishing colors. This one looks at images or sample images and generates color color information from the sample image. So depending on if you find an image you like, it'll pull out colors that go nicely from that particular image, which is a nice way of getting good quality colors. So you can click on this little create button, and when you do that, you could create a color or a palette, but we're going to go to this image DNA. And maybe it'll load for me. Try to reload it, see if I can get it to load. There we go. And so I can choose to open a file. There's a bunch of images that are preloaded. If I were to pick one of those preloaded, I can then choose how many colors, 3, 5, or 7, that come from this particular image. I could also specify that I didn't like that color and I wanted a different color, but there is an automated way of going through it. But I can also, if I go back to open, I could choose to upload my own image. So if I had an image that I liked that I wanted to upload, I could go find that image, see if I have any back from 104. I could upload that and it would give me a color scheme based on that particular image. So it's kind of an interesting way of going about creating a color palette. So I'll pick 5 colors, then I'll click on the Save button. And when I do that, it's going to ask me, do I want it to be an Illustrator, Photoshop, or a GIMP file? So we're going to go ahead and choose that I want it to be an Illustrator file. And there it comes down as mycolor.ai. So let me show it in the folder and let me copy it. And once again, I'll put it onto my flash drive. And this time it's only 5 colors, so I'll download the sample file with only 5 colors. There it is. There's the 5 colors. And I'll go ahead and load up that last set. So let me go to the flyout menu, open Swatch Library, Other Library. Oops, wrong class. And it's the mycolor.ai. I'll go ahead and say open. And that then loads up that set of colors. So once again, I can pick on each of my squares here. And I can assign, I can assign those colors and then save for web for that as well. Okay, so you create 2 separate posts. You'll upload your swatch file and the JPEG as your featured image, right? One from each website, one from Palatin, one from Colored, right? Then you'll also upload your Charlie Harper. And then in part 5, I want you to think through what your color scheme for Charlie Harper should be. And you can choose to use one of these websites or not, but it would be nice if you saved a set of swatches that you could then use easily in your Charlie Harper. So think through that. You don't need to comment on this post. So you're off the hook for comments. And I want to remind you that your Charlie Harper is due a week from today. Okay. So next class, we'll talk about architectural diagramming, and we'll get into some more Illustrator techniques, some of which will be helpful in your Charlie Harper. We'll talk about that live paint tool again, which we talked about before, but I'll go through it again so that you guys can see it again live. Are there any questions? Nope. All right.